Did you get timestamps?
Hey, everybody. Welcome to...
Nailed it! Sorry!
Welcome to your eardrums being blasted out. This is our 24-hour live stream. And Zoe feels so good about herself right now because she was able to do our introduction and recording at the right time.
I'm sorry, Toby. What? I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
My ears are fine. Luckily, over years of like destroying my eardrums, I think I'm actually
that's
at a gonna point
look
where
so
I can do
that. That's going to sound so bad in VOD too.
So what we're on to now, on our 24-hour live stream, we are doing a bit of it's something which I'm very cautious in doing because caster personalities normally don't take criticism well.
Exhibit A.
Exhibit A. Hey, I accept what I am. I unless I see your point, like if you criticize me for no apparent reason, you have no backing behind it, then... yeah, I'm going to get pissed at you.
And in general, people love the drama that goes in the scene and the personalities between. So critiquing can oftentimes be seen as just shot
jealousy.
Fire.
Yeah.
But it's
like, oh my God, because you did that. Obviously, you did it wrong. And be like, oh, that's just because you're jealous. You can't do this. And it's just like, seriously, like, it's not the. I don't have to measure every freaking time. Like, it's like, I know my size. He knows his size. And we can all just get along together. All right.
And I'm pretty sure after the Christmas year awards came out, where both Join Dota community, voted you for the best caster, like 50%, and then the Ghosts of Gamers community.
Well,
also
that's the funny thing with the Ghosts of Gamers community. I never got actually awarded the best caster. What I got awarded was always the community award. Like the community would always vote for me, which. It's fantastic. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, that could just be a popularity contest. Who's got the most amount of followers on said website that is doing things. So, yeah.
Even if you don't like Toby, you can at least acknowledge that he's good at what he does. Like, even if his casting isn't up your alley, you can at least acknowledge that he knows.
Yeah. As far as experience goes, too, like, I've been doing LAN events since 2007. I've done it in all conditions. Like... The worst possible conditions we could talk about was hanging a... Like, we actually tore apart a headset to grab the microphone to plug into someone's laptop. This was back in 2007, so laptops back then was like... I hope it doesn't blow itself up. And we dangled that microphone in front of the PA system because we couldn't hook the PA into the laptop. And we cast from the PA system and we streamed out audio only. Back in those days. And that place got struck by lightning at the same time. And you think I'm joking about that, but I'm not. We actually got struck by lightning. That was a LAN event in Malaysia at the Afamosa Resort. Good times. Good times. I've done a lot of online casting, a lot of LAN casting, so I got experience from a lot of different areas. You grow as a caster as well from the very, very start. Like, there's things which I know now which I had no clue about the very, very start. There's things I know now which I didn't know 6 months ago. Like, you continue to always learn something as a caster, and that's something you've got to be able to do is self-evaluation. It's a primary thing, and actually understanding why you said what you said. Like, if you can get through that, then you're going to be okay. If you can't get through that, good luck being a caster. You'll probably never learn anything. So our first person that came off the rank, I took the Borel versus Scotty game from Sivo because I kind of want to take two teams which normally people wouldn't know a hell of a lot about. Okay. And it's with him casting with Nahaz as well. So it's a different kind of situation to what like we might see Helium in other situations, which is solo casting. Which is a very different style of casting to dual casting. In fact, like when I first started casting, I refused to cast anybody else apart from one guy called Veriton. And I cast with him straight for 3 months and we worked on our synergy as a pair. And this is something which doesn't really happen these days. Like these days people are just like chopping and changing. It's like, oh, we want to have this person now. Oh, we want to have this person now. And no time actually gets put into working together as a team. In a broadcast, like you put maybe 5 minutes of time in beforehand when you would talk about, okay, how do you want to approach this? Like for both Syndra as well as Luminous, who I work with at TI4, all they wanted to do was get together so we could talk about teams and information so we could feel prepared for the game. But not like either of them didn't say, hey, how are we going to approach this broadcast? Like, what's the good points here and there? Like, with Syndra and I, it's a little bit easier, but of course, Syndra's also changed a lot over the last 12 to 18 months. So you have to rework how to do your synergy for that one. But yes, so what we're going to do is we're going to listen to short little snippets, and I'm basically just going to take some points away from things that he says, does, etc. I believe Helium was not using a camera for this one because he went directly into the draft, so we won't be talking about on-camera kind of stuff, so it's just direct audio practically. Cool. So I'm just going to make sure this is turned up a little bit more so people can hear it. Also so I can hear it, because the cat, my in-ears are so low now. Mr. Production, can you hit auto without hitting the TV or the computers that's behind you? Yeah, the computer's behind you is actually what I'm talking about.
So we left the production area.
So that computer's worth like $4,000. That's right. Fine.
It's not the PC, it's the outer casing.
That's actually the PC in there too. Like, what's falling down is going to be the sides. Anyway, back to what we're doing. All right, so let's just have a listen for a moment. I want to take from the start. I know he gave me 11-minute mark point, but I want to hear his start.
Hello and welcome everyone to another night of SIVO Season 6. We'll start off in Week 3-2 for a match between Scotty Doesn't Know and Boreal Esports, and we'll have one more coming up at 9 p.m. Eastern. That'll be a Week 4 match. But before we get too far, I'm Helium, and joining me is Nahaz. How are you doing?
Okay. Just from the start, I want to say he's ticked most of the boxes that I'd want to have ticked at the start of a broadcast.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, you can do it as just kind of like a method thing through your head. When you start a broadcast, especially like when you do a VOD like this, I want to know what tournament I'm watching. I want to know the status of the tournament. Now, it's difficult to show that in detail unless you have a whole lot of draft, group stage overlays and things like that. So we did the simple thing of saying it's Season 6, Week 3-2, even though I have no idea what the 3-2 means. I'm assuming it's Week 3, Play Day 2. But it gives me some level of reference that I'm actually into the tournament. He said name of the teams. I actually said the full name of the teams as well, even though I actually don't like the fact that the overlay is covering the team names. But I'm assuming this is just because it's the way CEO designed it.
Yeah.
You can't put that one on the caster. And he introduced his co-caster straight away. I didn't feel bored. I didn't feel like he didn't care to be there. It sounded like, okay, we're definitely going through another game. But it was a good introduction. And instantly he also got the information out, went straight to his co-caster and asked him an open-ended question.
Right.
How are you doing? So when you start off with a broadcast, like, yo, hey, everyone, welcome to SIVO Season 6. We've got SDK going up against Burrell. I'm Toby One, and joining me is Dodo Capitalist. Cap, what's happening, man? And you have that, and it instantly transfers it from you to the other person. And that's one of those, like, important things you got to try and do in a broadcast where you don't just talk the entire time. A broadcast should be a conversation. And you go and have a conversation by spending 20 minutes yourself talking about it. It has to switch to the other person. So yeah, it's kind of important that you get that balance. So far off, and that's literally everything I gained from 20 seconds of listening to him.
Later on, though, real quickly about the open-ended question. Later on, though, when you develop synergy with a person, you don't always have to end with an open-ended question.
No, you right? don't. In fact, actually, that's the best type of commentary you can have is when you don't have to do that.
Right.
Like, I remember when we first started casting online, and I told you one of the old secrets, let's say the old secrets, just the old strategy which you could use, which was the ability just to say someone's name at the end of a sentence.
Right.
Because it's a mental kicker. So the second you say, all right, so happening now on bottom lane, it looks like they're all going to die. I'm not quite sure, Dota Capitalist, what do you actually think about that one? Like, I'm asking you a question that one, but I'm actually doing two things. I start with your name, mm-hmm. which whenever someone mentions your name, your ears will instantly prick and your brain goes, wait, this is my turn to speak.
Yeah.
And then you're like, okay, I can hear the end of the sentence, so it's my turn to come in.
Right.
So that's just two basic things you do for queuing into the next part. But it's also one of those things where you do it and you break the flow.
Mm-hmm.
Because one, you're assuming that your co-caster is not listening to you. Because if you actually have to say a verbal trigger to get his attention,
right,
he's not listening to what you're saying. That's kind of like the primary thing. Listen to your co-caster.
But an example of something that doesn't have to have a question, something like, it looks like we're going to be having one hell of a game on our hands there, Toby.
And yeah.
Instantly it just passed. Because it's so natural once you say its name, the name, it's instantly like a pass-off. It's just very natural to...
All right, let's listen to a little bit more because I want to hear also how Nahas responds and how quickly it comes back and forth. Because I know you're a fan of Nahas.
I do. I really like Nahas. As a
all right, guy. So let's have
I'm doing great, man. I'm good to be back into Dota here. I've not had much time lately, but boy, the metagame sure has shifted in the last couple of weeks. Right off the bat, we get a Juggernaut ban, and boy, with what we've seen recently, it's hard to argue with that.
Yeah, that is pretty much the shift right there. Ban or pick Juggernaut because the hero is really good. It's been buffed like continuously over the last couple patches, and now people finally realizing just how strong it is.
Okay. Again, I got a lot of positive stuff to say, which I honestly didn't know if I was going to say positive stuff during this.
This is why I grabbed Helium. I think Helium's actually a really legit amateur caster.
As far as doing the core things, he's doing it right. Mm-hmm. Nahas brings up the point that Juggernaut's being banned out, and he referred it to the meta. Now, what Helium did correctly straight after that is he listened first to his co-caster and what he said,
right,
and he acknowledged that through his own comments. So he says, okay, yes, he referenced the Juggernaut, mm-hmm, and he referenced the fact that the way like it's been changed in the meta is he keeps getting buffs. Now, you don't need to go into mass amounts of detail with this one. Like, you still have to remember this is a broadcast. This is like it's not an analysis. They're two very different beasts. When you do something like this, you're not going to sit down and go, okay, well, Juggernaut, we've had this kind of change. He said his base armor changed. This has happened this way. We can reference this game, and this game, where teams said, you know, okay, I'm going to grab this one because we can use it in this manner, and so on and so forth. Like, if you're going to do that, do a Juggernaut special and release it as a YouTube video because that's where that content belongs. It doesn't fully belong in a broadcast unless you're bored out of your brain and they're taking 5 million years to get the next pick, at which point it becomes your filler content. But it's not normally something you want to put into this because you want to keep people's thoughts moving from one thing to the next thing to the next thing to the next thing. Because the second you get caught up on one thing and you just try and break that one down, you've just realized you spend 5 minutes talking about that one and you want to spend then 30 seconds talking about the next thing. Like, there's no balance in your topics. There's right. no balance in your subjects.
Especially when the audience can see that the draft is progressing, but you're still stuck on the same subject.
Yeah. And sometimes, like, it's harder as a caster to stop doing that because some things you're really, really like, oh my God, it's going to be this. I really want to see this. Or like, it's something which you feel personally invested in and you want to talk about because it's just, it's important to you.
Right.
And what's important to you, you normally want to express during a broadcast. Right now, I say we're looking good. Let's actually jump forward because that's just basic interaction. We might go through a lot of these other points in the future. But we're going to jump to the 11-minute mark, which is where we want to look at a team fight coming out. So let's just have a listen. I'm hoping it's loaded in some manner of level. It's 11 minutes?
I believe it's 12 minutes. He has 12:26.
Yes, 12:26.
And that's for first blood. Spoilers, first blood.
Really? Okay. Remember, it's the YouTube timer. So we're actually only like a minute into the game. We've already got Puck Low. And that's at 12:01. All right, so we'll start from here. We might have some...
Lane, KVH. Quality. Very, very solid player here playing on that Shadow Fiend. It'll be Lion in the bottom lane played by Loki. He'll be protecting that Anti-Mage, that 747, and Omni Knight support. Maybe going to duo in the offlane for a little while. That's going to be Footsie.
I just want to say, before we even get to the team fight, how useful it is to do what he just did. Not a lot of casters still do this these days, primarily because it kind of feels like you're just going through the motions. But you have to remember who your viewer base is. Your viewer base is not just the people who play Dota all the time. Like, the people you actually want to reach as a broadcaster are the people who don't play Dota all the time, who don't know about the competitive scene, who want to actually try it and understand this a little bit more. So what he does right there is kind of like what most basic casters will do, and that's run through the lanes and run through who's playing what. Mm-hmm. Now, you can expand on this when you do it. So you say, like, it's like Omni Knight, well, maybe he's going to be like dual laning up on the top kind of thing. Like, you can say that, and then you can branch out with those kind of thoughts. But what you do is you bring the viewer's attention to who's on what lanes. So you can think of it as like Fog of War for a broadcast. A viewer will only know what you bring them, like what you bring to attention to them. So you're okay, I'm looking at the middle lane, I'm looking at Dendi versus S4, all I talk about is Dendi and S4. My Fog of War doesn't know the top or the bottom lane.
Right.
I honestly don't give a crap, because why should I? Like, you've given me no reason to think, okay, this is an important lane or this is an important lane. Like, there will be the competitive players out there that are watching it who are getting really, really frustrated because they want to look at the other lanes. But most people who are watching it, they don't really care, because they're trusting in their broadcaster to keep them focused. So this is one of those things where giving everyone just a touch of like where everyone's meant to be in the lanes is really, really good. An extension of that, when you start your broadcast, you should talk about where people will then transition to.
Right.
Because it's all about preparing people for what's going to come. So you say, well, First Blood will probably happen on middle lane because the Shadow Fiend's going to hit this timing and have this amount of burst damage, which is going to be a really good timing up against the mid solo, and this will happen roughly around the 4-minute mark. But we have to keep our eyes on, like, the VS and the Earthshaker for the roaming rotations. So by just saying a phrase like that, you're going to have people go, okay, I'm going to watch my minimap to see when I see two people move away. At the same time, I know that I should probably be keeping a closer eye on the mid lane every time the camera is looking at that area. Mm-hmm. Or at least looking at the health bars of the hero on the top. So you prepare the viewer for what's going to come without saying, yo guys, make sure you watch this. It's going to happen in this area, because that doesn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't want to make things too obvious, because like, you want to prepare them for it, but you don't want to spoil the surprise, if you understand what I mean. So it's this balance of, you give them subliminal messages, but you then you come in with a kicker, which is when it happens, but they're just like, oh my god, that was so good. I knew that was going to happen, and now I can feel it like really good as a viewer, that I kind of knew that was going to happen. But they never really fully understand why. Okay, let's watch the team fight.
If you want
to finish the first blood players. Yeah, we've got Elon on the mid, Night Stalker. Oh, a little action down bottom as Jeeves is going to mix it up for the second time with this Lion and AM duel already on his solo offlane Phoenix. And then we've got the safe lane, tri lane around that Medusa. We've got Iraq.
I hate to say at this point, Nahas makes a mistake. Mm-hmm. This can happen so easily. I'm sorry, Nahas. So I feel really guilty about it.
he didn't sign up to get critiqued, Toby.
No, he didn't.
Let him be.
No, he didn't.
No, what's up?
So what you do is, like, you have to understand when it's worth interrupting.
Right.
Now, I've gotten in a lot of trouble for this because people don't understand it, or I didn't understand it at the time as well, that nothing was going to happen.
Right.
So when you look at a Phoenix on the offlane, like, if he hadn't used Icarus Dive, mm-hmm. then that's something happening right now.
Right.
But what Nahas did is go, it looks like now down on bottom lane, something's about to happen. Mm-hmm. And when the camera comes down there, even if it was looking from the start, unless we visibly saw him do an Icarus Dive, we're still going to have the same reaction of, what the fuck are you talking about? Mm-hmm. Like, I look at that as a viewer and I go, Nahas has no clue. He loses credibility by actually interrupting to say, this is something important, when yep. it's not important. So he would then be able to, like, redeem himself by, because he was going through a process. He stopped his own process of introducing this lane, and this lane, mm-hmm. because Helium did one side and Haas does the other. It's a weird kind of trade-off thing. Very,
yeah, I was going to ask.
It's very round
that.
By round by round base kind of thing.
Personally, I hate that when you try and pass it off to your co-caster to do the other side of the introductions. I think that is very, very clanky. Unless you have somebody you have a lot of synergy with, I don't think that you should be doing that. Personally, I feel like there's too much.
Most of the time, I prefer when you do a lane introduction, mm-hmm. you don't do team by team.
Right.
You do lane by lane.
Yes.
So if you want to pass it off, and if you want to make it more of like that bounce back and forward kind of thing with your partner, You do it more in a way of just like, you know what, I'm really loving this aggro tri lane, which they've managed to like pull this hero, and this hero in, and I think it's going to be massively effective because they've got this stun combination to work, and this is what they want to achieve with it, and it's powerful against this hero because of this. So maybe they need to bring extra heroes up towards the top lane, and then your co-casting can go, well, if they do that, then they're going to destroy my bottom lane, which is looking really good by having their aggro tri lane. So let that top hero just bunker themselves in and try and survive, but they want to see this synergy coming out from this hero, and this hero to work up against this hero in this manner. So you actually, you don't just say something for the sake of saying it, like the whole like monkey see, monkey say kind of thing. That's the kind of stuff which radio broadcasters do by default, and I'm still very guilty of doing this myself because that's what I grew up with. Like, I remember my grandfather's words when I would walk into the sunroom and he's sitting there and he's watching the cricket and listening to the radio. And I'm like, yo, granddad, like, why don't you just turn the TV audio on? Like, they've got commentators on there as well. He's like, I prefer listening to the commentators on the radio because they actually talk about things. And that was one thing which you don't really fully understand until you start listening to things. When, you ever listen to a guy who started doing video commentary from the very, very start? Mm-hmm. And what they do is they let the visuals do the work for them.
Right.
Now,
which is both a good thing and a bad thing at the same time, right?
It's a good thing if the visuals are actually doing the work.
Right.
Like, but if we took it to an extreme, the visuals doing the work, you wouldn't say anything during a team fight. Mm-hmm. You'd just be randomly talking about, like, well, okay, that Medusa timing was a little bit off with her, like, her stone gaze. Like, that was... Because people's like, that. Well, we can see that anyway. Mm-hmm. Like, so why should we care? Mm-hmm. But it's too much of an extreme.
Right.
But sometimes you can, like, again, it's that whole thing of balance. You've got to find that right level of descriptive terms, and then you've got to actually say why you're saying it. You got to give context to why you're saying it. So everything should be connected. Now, when you get tired, when you stream for long hours, you just say what's on the screen. Like, that's going to happen. Your logical like thoughts die off so quickly. Like, players have to keep their concentration, casts have to keep their concentration for a very long period of time. Like, your primary focus level, like where you can keep 100% focus on what you're doing, is normally only going to last maybe 5 to 10 minutes. Like, that's as much as you can get. And then your brain kind of has to shut down a little bit. And that happens, that's when you ignore your co-caster. That's when you
repeat points that your co-caster already said, yeah. Or you don't have any flow. They make an interesting point, but you just are like, oh, it's my turn to talk. I'm going to talk about this now.
Yeah, because that's an interesting point for you. And then you both share the same interesting point. And it's like, Right. Well, you don't give respect to your co-caster. It's not that. It's because you're burnt out as a caster. That's why I'm going to go a little bit off tangent from casting right now and talk about actually oversaturation of the Dota scene. It's not just a problem for players who cannot show unique strategies or can't develop themselves or they can't come in fresh and give 110%. It's the same thing for broadcasters. If you keep someone casting all the time, one, they lose their passion because casting, it really is an expression of passion. But you also take away the ability for the brain to function. Because you're just burnt out. You can suck down as much Red Bull or any kind of energy drinks as you want to, but it's not going to make any difference because all you do then is wire your brain, but you don't actually produce more logical thought by doing that. You'll keep your eyes open, you'll keep your mouth moving, but it doesn't increase the content you're actually achieving.
Right.
Yeah. So that's just one of those things. So eventually we'll get to this team fight. I don't know how long we're taking with this right now, but it's a good thing we got our 24-hour stream today.
That being said, Nahaz does something, though, that I would say is pretty advanced that you normally wouldn't hear co-casters pull off, which is the recovery, right? He made the mistake, but he transitioned that into fulfilling what he was supposed to do in the first place, which he interrupted his own thought, but then he was able to make that transition.
He doesn't get lost. He doesn't get lost. It's like, well, there's actually happening a bottom lane, and then it's like, oh, wait, didn't really happen.
Yeah, so he ends up introducing the Phoenix and then moving on, which helps soften the blow of that hard thought of, oh, this is happening. It didn't happen.
Yeah. All right. Let's try this again.
Aj on the Earthshaker, Illest on the Vengeful Spirit, and the big snake lady herself is Korean barbecue.
Delicious.
we're going to take forever to get to the super. Descriptive terms, which are not heroes' names. The Korean snake lady. We say the snake lady Korean barbecue. I don't know if you actually combine the two.
Yeah, I think he's snake lady.
But you call a snake lady, like, pet names, nicknames, mm-hmm. unique things. This is what makes an individual brand.
Right.
Like, if every single person said exactly the right abilities and the right names and absolutely everything, nothing would be unique about you, and you may as well just roll out a generic caster, which is, like, set to go off like an announcer pack. Like, you'll have nothing really come. It's like, oh, Medusa gets a triple kill. That's it. So I like it when people inflict that kind of stuff. Now, you might get hatred for this, and I want to say right now, ignore the hatred. Because it really doesn't make much sense for you to stop being yourself in a broadcast. So hold on to some of these little things. Like, I will never say Illuminate during a team fight. I will always say Caudal Blast. But there are some things which will go against that rule. And I'm going to use another example of mine. Shuki.
Shuki.
Now, the word is Shikuchi. Now, I initially changed this because I was worried during team fights I couldn't get everything out that I wanted to anymore because I try to push myself further in the team fights. Yeah. So I thought if I start to shorten words, then it'll be okay. And I also have a very lazy tongue. Most people will understand this when they hear me, like, I blur different words or, like, things don't really sound 100% correct. I don't know what... You guys were actually abusing me yesterday about some other word I was saying. You're just like, it's so not that. What was it about?
I don't remember.
It was in the...
Oh, you were saying H. You were H.
Yeah.
H. You were actually putting an H in the word H.
Because we're saying... It was saying H-Y-H-Y. And because I say H-Y-H-Y, I don't know, I understand exactly why I do it, but... Like, maybe it's a corrector way to pronounce H, because normally, like, the older English way of saying H, you actually have to breathe out when you say H. Mm-hmm. So it's ha when you say H. But most people, like, just cut back on that. And most Australians actually cut back on that crap as well, because we're just like, why should we make the frickin' effort? But I thank my English heritage for that. Yeah, you're all just... What? Okay, I got Zoe and Dirk are both squirming over here because I'm saying H. They cannot take it. And you can have people like that on the live stream as well. Like, what these guys are doing right now is exactly what your viewers are going to do when they're watching the live stream. Because they'll just be like, you're like, what the hell is he saying? He's like, H-Y-H-Y. Isn't it meant to be hi-hi? Isn't it meant to be H2? Like, what was it really meant to be? And the simple thing is, like, you don't know until you ask the player exactly what his name is meant to be. And his name was actually H-Y-H-Y.
No, it was hi-hi.
It's actually hi-hi? Oh, no,
he called himself hi-hi.
That's
you
right.
Call them H-Y-H-Y, and then he kind of the rest of the scene, including himself, followed suit with H-Y-H-Y.
That's right. It was Kurikai. It was Kurikai.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Kurikai was the one I was actually right about, because Kurikai's original name, like, everyone in the European scene called him Kuroki. But he actually intended this name to be Kurikai. But because everyone in the European scene called him Kuroki, he was just like, I accept it. I really don't care. Yeah. And then I was just like, well, is it Kurikai? Because everyone's kept flaming me for it, so we all call him Kuro. Gap between the two. But yeah, you'll always have these kind of things where, like, you want to shorten things down, you want to have it as a quirky thing for yourself, so hold on to that kind of stuff. Don't let it go unless you're really freaking wrong by saying it. All right. To the team fight.
I just want to say there is a difference between the two, right? Caudal Blast is like a descriptive term, and it's actually used throughout the scene in general. Nobody calls it Illuminate in the pro player scene. Nobody says Illuminate incoming.
Yeah. Right?
But it's also kind of a descriptive element. Shuki, people, it's not like really descriptive in any way. It's more people are just like, oh, you're not pronouncing it right.
You're right. If it graphically explains what's actually happening on the screen,
right,
then it's a lot easier to get past.
Yeah.
Yeah, like Snake Lady, it's Medusa. Everyone fucking knows, like, Medusa is Snake Lady. That's fine. All right, team fight. We'll eventually get that. Or at least the first blood.
It's good stuff, man.
Yeah, looking at this Phoenix matchup, though, this lane, it kind of sucks for Phoenix, because the hero, you don't really think about it, but after a couple levels, Phoenix becomes very mana-dependent on launching the Fire Spirits and also, like, Sunray. So having the mana burn in the lane, it is not great. But we'll see a wraparound up top. Araz just making sure 470 has to pay some respects to the Earthshaker.
Yeah, but Earthshaker needs to be careful. He's only got one Tango left, and this Puck is going to... That's a lot of harass. That's too much harass to eat right there.
Yeah, I don't know if that trade was too great. He can maybe stack a camp and just roll back, or they'll run into Illist. They do have the mana here, so a stun into a Fissure is what they're going to go for. That's going to keep him stunned. Good chain stunning, and they'll get the attacks.
Very nice.
And that's the first very blood nice. From Mirage, so he baits in the Puck.
Yeah.
Okay. What I want to say first is... I was interested in that first blood without someone screaming at me. Mm-hmm. Because the play doesn't call for someone screaming at me. What the play was a simple stun into a follow-up Fissure with enough damage to get a kill on a hero who overextended. Like, they gave it the right amount of tone, the right amount of enthusiasm for the play it was. Like, if this was TI4 Grand Finals, then we might have been going... Oh, Puck's up too far! The VS! He's gonna go over the sun! Why in your face with the Fissure? Ah! Like, maybe then for the TI4 Grand Finals, you would do that because it's first blood. It's gonna be, like, a big changer. But for a game of this level, you shouldn't do that.
Right.
Like, there's times and places for screaming.
Unless their stakes are really, really high, there's no reason to hype up something that's very normal.
Exactly, because that means next time you try and hype something up, it means nothing.
It doesn't have the same effect.
Yeah. So if you ever listen to a broadcast and someone's just screaming at you the entire time. Now, if you listen to my original broadcast, that's basically what I was doing. Like, I was massively trying to hype, and I feel really sorry for anyone that's tried to follow my footsteps from my original, like, first year of Dota 2 casts. Because it really sends you up the garden path without a paddle. Because it takes away from that credibility we're talking about before as a commentator. Why should people care? Like a co-caster, people want to care about the intellectual things they say. A play-by-play person, people want to care about when they're supposed to get excited. If they're meant to get excited, and they get excited, and they realize, I'm not meant to be excited, they're like, what the fuck? Like, why are you doing this to me? Like, why am I feeling these emotions when I shouldn't feel these emotions? So, yeah. So I'm going to say, they both played it off nicely. Nahaz actually did something which a lot of co-casters don't do because they fear it's going to throw off the play-by-play guy. And that's just going, that was really nice. That was nice. That's nice, nice. Like, key word coming in from a co-caster which actually helps set the mood for things. Now, Cinder and I actually try to do some of this kind of stuff when we did TI broadcasts. And a couple of things also for, like, defense matches, because he wanted to have, like, the whole, like, wah! Sound effect coming in from the side when something really awesome happened.
Yeah.
So he wanted to be he wanted to be more like Artosis and Tasteless, the way they function together. Mm-hmm. The way they function is amazing. Amazing as a pair, because they've known each other for so long, they're such good friends as well, that they just know when the next person's going to do something else, and then they know when they can blend together as well, and they get a really, really good balance. This is what comes over years of casting as a pair. And what they just managed to achieve in a very short amount of time still achieves very, like, a similar goal. It wasn't perfect because Helium did actually get a little bit flustered in his calling, because normally you don't talk over the top of somebody. Yeah. So it's very unnatural for me to keep talking and then Cap say nice, 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 and I'm going back to what I was taught before, which was to respond to everything he says. So I'm just like, yes, that was nice. What am I doing now? Let's top lane. VS is moving back into the lane now. I look for some level of recovery where I can get myself back into some level of flow.
Right.
What was her next time mark?
21:50.
21:50.
And Helium even put in a note that he said he put just meh next to it. So I think he recognized the fact he kind of stumbled there from the Haas's response. And
okay.
But
well, okay. So 21:50. I kind of want to take it back before this because I'm already seeing a Fissure down the ground. So I'm going to take it back to whatever.
Back up. There are three heroes behind 21:40. Him. 21:40. Trying to push down the tower.
Yeah, and they need something at this point. They realize that they're giving up a lot early game to a lineup full of carry heroes. You know, they need to get something here. They need to make sure that Boreal don't have map control.
Short thing, Helium knew when not to interrupt. He let Nahaz keep talking because he realized it wasn't a kill.
Right.
I'm looking forward to Venge hitting six because I think the Fisher to the swap out on Puck is probably going to be quick enough to throw the damage on. They didn't quite have it right there, so Puck just escaped.
Yeah, I think that's probably right. I mean, swap, obviously, one of the big impact skills. I mean, there's a reason that you see Venge pick so often, and swap is obviously a big part of it.
Yeah, and everyone that has to play Venge probably hates that. I don't know. The hero is obviously one of the best. In terms of
when you say something, gross generalizations are Castle's worst enemy. People who play Venge probably hate that. Why? It's a weird thing for me to go on because I also am very guilty of this. Mm. But if you're gonna say something as a fact, follow up your fact with some level of like reinforcement.
Right.
Or else people are just like, he's spouting shit.
Or in this case, like, if it's a bit of a joke, right?
Yeah, if it's a joke, like, where is the giggle?
Oh, because you're always going to be dying, you know?
Yeah, something like that. Like, that would work. Like, you have to say, like, because you don't have people who can read your facial expressions. You don't know, like, oh, you're going to smoke on your face.
It's very hard to put that out through your voice that you're joking or being sarcastic.
Yeah,
or
so it's very easy to be misunderstood. The second you start taking away mediums, means you have to work harder with what you still have left. Yeah, so just a small little thing.
Ouch. Yeah, Reeves has just been out of position a couple of times. I mean, you know, not necessarily huge errors, but boy, when you're against that Lion AM lane, you know, obviously one of the biggest farmers in the game and a support here that benefits so much from XP early on.
Oh, they're trying to get 470. I think with the dots lined up, they will just be able to. Yeah,
very nice.
Jesus is going to line
they
it
needed
in.
That
oh,
kill.
Is he going to have to egg? No, he'll live.
No, he's okay. He's okay. Dire's bottom
tower is under. That was okay. It was, again, a very... I don't need to get hyped about it. Again, it was another one of those, like, Fissure stuns. Like, sure, you could be, like, bringing into attention. Like, he actually is not a negative caster at all. Like, a lot of casters are very, very negative about these kind of points.
Yeah.
Like, before you could have said, well, where was the phase shift? Now you could be like, yeah, screws up the Fissure. It's when, like, someone starts a conversation and they say no first. Or they say something negative first. And instantly, you put in a negative mood. Or you put it in an adversarial kind of mood. Like, you're wondering, okay, why are you telling me no? Okay, you're agreeing with me. Oh, wait, what the, hang on. You get conflicted as a viewer. And the same kind of thing can happen when you try and set a mood for a broadcast. You want someone to actually be happy. Like, I don't think you ever really go out of your way and go, you're going to feel fucking miserable while you watch this broadcast because you're going to hate the crap Dota that's being played. Like, you don't want to go in with that kind of mindset. And it's kind of like something like you put your own mindset into that. So you're like, you know, I'm actually feeling negative about this game. So then you'll normally comment about what's negative. So that kind of stuff can happen a lot as a broadcaster. Yeah, but I like the way it's actually more positive than he is negative about these kind of things. What's the last time mark for this VOD?
That is going to be 38:40.
Okay.
On the YouTube.
I'm sorry, Helium. I think I've taken so long with this thing. 38:40?
Yep.
Okay. I think I've taken so long on this thing, I think this should only be the only video for you before we go to a question.
Monovoid got buffed like four straight times.
Did the conversion to damage get buffed though? I thought it was just the radius and the stun. Or not the stun, but
I wanna say that the damage got buffed at least a little bit, but yeah, it just feels like that ability now is a staple of AM's arsenal. I mean, a lot more AM players are looking to use that more aggressively.
I'm actually seeing Cap now having an issue with... Is it because of the content of what they're saying?
No, I'm pretty sure that Animage, his damage didn't get buffed. But that's...
But the funny thing is, like, you know how Nahas covered his tracks?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure. Which basically allows you to say anything you want to after that, because you can say, I'm not 100% about this.
Right.
This isn't law, this isn't Bible. So even if he's right or wrong about that, it doesn't matter as far as the way he's doing the broadcast.
Right.
We've been seeing it just...
If you make a mistake like that when it comes to an analysis, a good way is to, if you make a bad call like that or something, you reinforce what you know is right.
Yes.
So it, you say, okay, you know, that might not be 100%, but the important thing is with that AoE buffed up so much, blah, 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 it becomes so much more useful and effective in teamfights or something like that. So
you're 100% correct.
So that way, even if you're wrong, it doesn't hurt your analysis, the point you're trying to make.
Yep. All right, let's see what he has in store
for
us for this
no
clip.
Reason, like, just in case, even the top level. I forget the... Was it Black that was doing it a lot?
Oh, it's been a number of players. Illidan's been doing it. Yeah, Black, of course.
The reason it kind of escaped me, but...
You got what you're searching for. Like, he didn't know about Black, but he knew Illidan did.
You
got what you're looking for in there.
But I guess if they have a TP, proving your point straight away, that you can just chop them twice, then it doesn't really matter.
But no, I mean, with the 500 radius now, I mean, that spell can just do a crap ton of damage.
Yeah, don't stand next to Storm Spirit if you're playing against an anti-mage, as I...
It's good to laugh.
It's a pleasure of that happening to me.
But she's just not... You know, it comes down to Nightstalker right now.
Look at that Puck being a little cheeky there with the old Repel. Could maybe get swapped back, but... Well, he can get swapped back. I'm not sure how
You notice at that point, they walked over each other.
Yeah.
For a moment. Nahaz wanted to say something. Helium wanted to say something. This will happen even at LAN casting, but it happens a lot more when you're doing online casting because you can't see someone else's reaction. Do you notice also whenever we do LAN casting, no one ever sets up a caster's desk so the casters face each other?
Yeah.
That's actually one of the most frustrating things I actually feel. Everyone puts you on a flat desk. You can't have the screen slightly angled in. So you can actually look at each other and see someone else's reaction. One of those little things. So anyone that's ever watching that's trying to design a caster's desk, try and make them face each other. All right, back to the...
Look at AM, though.
Yeah, pushing up top.
Yeah, there goes your
looks like they're
barracks.
Just trading it. Both glyphs will go out. The tier 3 will fall in the mid lane, and 470 just buying some time, throwing out the coils. Doesn't have the ags yet, so it's not going to stun. Alon will run out of it. Now the GA goes... And I feel like it just still hit buildings in proximity, but unfortunately it doesn't. Korean Barbecue pulling out the double kill, and now...
I want to stop him halfway through. How many Dota players would know what a GA is?
Mm. Yeah, that's a good point. I didn't think about that.
And how many people who are new to the game would know what a GA is? This is when you want to get through more stuff as a broadcaster during a team fight. But you can't shorten it to a point that you take away meaning from what you say. Like, there's things like BKB, which is a little bit more general. And you wouldn't actually give, like a Black King bar, for example, to say those three words in a team fight doesn't really gain you much more than saying BKB. Like, there's some acronyms which are viable. But to say a GA, like, what are we referring to here? Hey. We assume it's going to be the Guardian Angel.
You're not going to see a whole lot of Omni Knight, so...
Exactly. It's not a consistent thing.
GA every game.
Yeah. So it's one of those small little things. I'm also looking at this team fight, and I don't feel the importance of what's going on.
Yeah.
Okay, so you've had an anti-mage pushing in through the top lane, trying to take a side racks. You've got a little bit of push coming in the bottom lane against your tier 2 tower... And SDK is trying to breach up to high ground. So, what do you want to prep your viewers for again? There's another one of those, like, actually help yourself before the team fight starts. So, they're talking about some interesting things. Like, you can't say, well, okay, I was bored by their conversation. But what I'm saying is, understand what's coming and take time to prepare for it. So, what you want to be talking about is the fact that Animage is up on top lane. He's pushing in the racks. The primary goal right now of the Radiant side is to make sure the Dire can't get back to stop him. Like, if we just look at this as a pure trade-off situation, it's top racks for mid racks. There's no other racks advantage available right now to the Dire side. So, as a team, you can look for this trade-off. And is that all they really want to do? And you can turn it around during the team fight when the SF jumps in, going, this has just turned from a stall into a fight. Look for the animation to come back then. Has he achieved his objective up on top lane? Is he coming back?
Right.
These are the kind of things where you have to... Like, you've still only got this area of the map when the map is huge. So what you focus on, you really have to make sure is important for the viewers who are watching. Or else they're going to be sitting there making up their own minds thinking, this is important to me instead. I want to know what's happening with the animation. I want to know what's happening with this. because I haven't been, like, an interest hasn't been sparked in what you're showing me so far. So prep yourself before the fight happens, and then, enhance it when the fight continues.
A good way to do that would be setting up the stakes for a team fight, right? Is basically,
yeah. What do you lose? What do you gain?
If they can actually fight this, if the enemies can get back and they can fight this, they can actually take that top laner Rax while still keeping their mid intact, and they'll be at a huge advantage. Like, that's a really good way of setting up a team fight, allowing the viewer to understand what the stakes are.
Yes. All right. Let's listen to the last part of the team fight.
The supernova, the egg burning 470. He's got to get out of there. Still being chased down by Jeeves. Arash going to jump in, though, getting two into that Echo Slam, following up with the Fisher. He is brought...
Wording during team fights? He picked up two. Again, the importance is lost. He just managed to grab, two big heroes from the dire side. Like, you've locked down two of what? The five heroes, which are kind of there anyway. But it's that important jump, which is meant to buy time. Then you look at, who's it buying time for? Where's the follow-up? He jumps in. What's the purpose? This is the kind of stuff where, we go from, okay, I'm going to use an FPS term here, which is kill calling. Now, kill calling is this person kills this person, 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 this person killed two people. Yay. It doesn't give any meaning to what's actually happening. And casters do this a lot when they look at team fights as well, because it's their saving grace when they've lost their focus during a broadcast. You go, two down, three down, four down, it's a whole team wipe, they're all dead, kind of thing. You do this as a safety net for yourself, because you're just like, well, okay, I blow in the team fight, I fucked it, what do I do now? The best thing I can do is go into recovery mode, and my recovery mode is to try and work out a 3-for-2 trade, or is it a 4-for-1 trade, or is it a genocide? Is this what I'm searching for? Is this the way I can then give the viewer an indication of who at least won the fight? So I don't tell them how it happened. I'll take care of that later. I could just at least for now say, this team won. My co-caster will just go, this was a really good point during the team fight. And then you can talk about that one afterwards while everyone's dead and they're regaining control of the lanes. So it's one of these little things where not every caster is going to get it right every single time. But at the same time, you get a lot of points for recovery. You just should try not to use recovery all the time. So add depth into your calls. Keep people's eyes moving with your voice. Yeah. All right, the end of the fight now.
Down, but he will find the kill onto KVH. Anti-Mage has come back after cleaning out that top lane completely for Scotty.
Jesus.
Scotty will get that melee Rax down, so it looks like the...
I instantly want to know why he said Jesus. I instantly want to know why he said Jesus. And I know I'm not going to get my answer for at least another 10 seconds.
Yep. Trade has been made. Korean barbecue still is still ages. Going on.
I take it back. Medusa still has Aegis. The hilarious thing is, too, he's showing this. This is the co-caster talking, but the play-by-play person is actually showing this at the same time he's saying it. So that's actually just a small little point. A small little nice point.
Yeah, still has the edge. It's unkillable now.
Jesus!
With the Scotty onto a mega kill streak. Make it a delayed triple just for this team fight. But now 747.
Nahas, never lose that. Never lose that. The way he says that is that unique juice I talk about with a certain person where he's just completely... that's the kind of enthusiasm that makes you laugh. It makes you smile. It makes you go, this is something I'm enjoying.
Mm-hmm.
Love it.
We'll bring down that Night Stalker. Korean barbecue is the only one alive, and we'll probably see him die twice here.
Ash too.
Actually, do they have any? They have okay, just the Basher, so they've got that 25% chance to cancel out a TP. But he's just running back to the base. Will he get there on the second life? They're going for the surround with the illusions. They're not going to quite get it. A manta of his.
This is a point when a cast is also going to keep minds on what else is happening on the map.
Mm-hmm.
So, purpose right now is Medusa trying to get back. Obviously, this is a focus. You've just had a Phoenix buy back into the game.
Yep.
What's she really going to do here? What's this bird really meant to achieve? And you should also flag the fact that support's coming in. Again, it's that set yourself up for what's about to happen. The Phoenix is about to come in. And what he focused on was something different. What he focused on was the surround around Medusa, trying to look for one of these surrounds. And that was his focus. Right now, you can look at this, and maybe, yeah, that could be it. Like, you go for the surround, but it's like, can they control him long enough? Nahaz was trying to do it. He was trying to bring attention to the fact that the Basher was there. So maybe this is the way they can have some level of control, but it's not an abyssal. So it's like, maybe it's not the greatest thing in the world to bring up. These are like the smaller decisions where you have to understand like what's important, and what's important to you might actually be very different to what's important to somebody else. It doesn't make it any wrong. Like it's still correct. Like maybe the most important thing is right now getting this around to make sure this Medusa has no mana burn. You get more time to hold it there. Can Buck help with that? And then look at what Phoenix is coming in. Again, this is one of those times where you look at a team fight and you understand just how much you can say and how much time you've got.
You have to read priorities.
Yeah.
What's going to have the biggest impact?
Exactly. Exactly.
Owen will allow Korean Barbecue to continue to run. And now that the Phoenix is back into the fray, he goes on to Footsie. The Mansa illusions are still running down that Omni Knight. Puck as well involved. 470 still trying to chase. We'll look back over to the Puck. Puck! You got to get out of there. We'll blink. Oh, I don't think you should have canceled that Sunray.
Lucky bastard.
Maybe it just ran out. I didn't quite catch it.
Yeah, that was awfully close.
What just happened there is dead air. Short, but the wrong time for it. Like, dead air is, to explain that term, dead air is when nothing is being said. When it's a radio term again, when you don't hear anything and you're thinking, what's my medium to get out there? Audio. And that's all I've got. Now, is the video actually doing the work here in this scene right now? So what did you see? You saw a Phoenix by back.
Mm-hmm.
We said he's back in the fray.
We saw Medusa and the illusion was going to be fine.
Yeah, we saw the Medusa was going to be fine, at which point then priorities, shift. Then shift, and you come down to what's happening with the Puck.
Right.
Because the Puck got in trouble. Like, Phoenix brought back for a reason. So you want to actually give justification to this, or at least see if there is a justifiable reason for the buyback.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he didn't get the kill. And you can accentuate the fact that the buyback was even more useless by the fact that Puck managed to get the RNG gods on his side, mm-hmm. and he picked up a regeneration rune.
There's also the positive side, which you can go at. He ensures the Medusa survives.
Very, very true.
If you want to keep more positive, that's just like a more.
You're right. It's that negative kind of positive kind of thing. So you can look.
Sometimes the negative is the right way.
Yeah.
Right? Sometimes you need to go. You can't always go positive about things.
And if you're always positive, you're biased to everybody. It's great. All right. I think that's the kind of like the last team fight. I want to see what they do after the dead air. And that's
well, Medusa is hard to kill. If we didn't know that already,
I thought it was more recent. Okay, thanks to Cart for the correction there.
Okay, a little bit disjointed, primarily because Nahaz gets attracted to stats. No surprise.
Stats, man, you.
But it's at least some level of summary I get at the end of a team fight. Like, what's my end resolution? Medusa is hard to kill. Hey, okay.
It's not a great resolution.
No, it's
something.
It's not the perfect thing in the world, but
it's obvious he's scrambling for closure. He knew there's dead air there.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
he came up with a bad.
But kind of what all this comes down to now is understanding the basics, and then you develop it into your own kind of flow, your own kind of style.
Yeah.
That's all this kind of stuff, like what we're doing right now, is going to achieve. It's not going to teach you about the energy and the rhythm of your own broadcast.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to give you pointers to actually help with that. But a lot of it is just discovering it yourself, and understanding how it works. It's like understanding your voice. Like, you can have a whole bunch of music teachers come in and teach you and say, you know what, this is how you should control your voice. This is how you should do it. But really, it's your instrument. It's unique to you. You'll probably be the only person that will ever fully understand it. And everything else everyone else has learned is based on their own experiences. That's how we learn. Like, you could study, but it's still based off someone else's experience. They just put to written word.
Right.
So, yeah, this is one of those things where experience does a lot, but try and work on your fundamentals. Okay, are we wanting to get Helium in now?
Yeah. Yeah, we can get Helium in.
All right, I'm assuming I'll just call him on this one.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So, we'll see if... Oh, wait, no, we can't do that. Yes.
Okay. Here.
Yes, it needs to be called on the other PC, because we don't have an input going in to this PC. Actually, we do. Because we have Dota TV hooked into this PC as well. So technically, we could have actually done it over on here, but it's set up to work on that one. And we have our own channel for that one. So yeah, when you get him hooked in, I'm going to be able to hear him. Yeah, so we're going to talk to the guy who was doing the number one role, the play-by-play casting in that. All right.
Calling. Busy.
God damn it, here. It's probably still watching. We're 1 minute into it. I'm hoping this also helped out a lot of other people. Like, this is... We look at Helium. That mic's still turned on, Cap. On the desk that you're tapping. You turn off that entire side. All right. So I'm hoping, actually, a lot of these points will not only help up-and-coming casters to think about other things. Okay, now he's saying, hey. To think about other things. Hope it helps upcoming commentators to understand. Okay, now he's trying to call you. Beautiful. Yeah. Hey, here we go. Yeah, I'm gonna finish the spiel before we start fully talking to you. But I hope it helps upcoming casters to understand the basics of broadcasting, and I hope it actually helps viewers as well to understand what casters one have to go through to do what they do, and also to appreciate who is a good commentator. Because a lot of people who like work hard, like myself, to improve themselves, when you have someone else come on and do a really terrible job at commentating, but they get a shit ton of praise, it really salts you a lot. So, remove the salt. All right, how you doing, Helium?
Apparently, he can't hear us.
Oh,
so
that's not good. He should be able to hear us. Can you check the audio? What's going in for him? Ooh. I think I've actually worked up a little bit of heat in here today. Hi. Can you hear me now?
Now I can hear you.
Perfect. Now, I don't know why. The new Skype keeps resetting all of that.
It's so, really good.
So how do you feel?
Pretty good. Well, you started with a lot of positives, so that worked out for me.
I tried to remain positive as possible, but you do have a lot of core things which you're doing right, which makes it a lot easier for this kind of stuff.
Yeah. I should note, I mean, I'm pretty familiar with Nahaz, like talking with him. We hung out at TI, but as for casting, we've only cast a handful of times, and this was the first time in a while, so there were sort of just some delays, and also it's an online cast, so...
Yeah. Yeah, as I was saying, online casting is always a little bit more difficult, and... Like I mentioned, Tasis and Artosis, those guys cast for years to get the synergy they get.
And they're probably the best, but... I don't know, I thought the casts overall, like, after cast, you obviously know how well you did. I thought it was okay, but there were obviously some moments where... That one in particular wasn't too great.
Did you have any thoughts about what I was saying or any other questions which you would have as a caster?
Well, personally, I thought the calling GA Guardian Angel, I don't know how big of a deal that is, because at the same time you said also don't change what you call things if it's like a nickname or a personal name for something.
It's primarily
that's
for
a little different.
It's primarily for understanding. As I said, like, you got to think about your viewership. Like, who's actually watching? So something will make a lot of sense to you. It will be very unique to you. But at the same time, you're still going to take into account that people have to have some understanding of what you're saying. Like what we're talking about before, like, you're never going to say Illuminate, but you can say Coddle Blast, and people can put the pieces together and understand exactly what you're talking about. But with GA, it's just two separate letters which don't really make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Because Omni Knight is not an angel. Like, if I thought it was Guardian Angel and Skywrath Mage is in the game, as a random user, my thoughts might just go to that instead. So this is just one of those things where you got to think about who exactly you're talking to, and the majority of who you're talking to, not the loud 5% who are pro players or believe they're pro players, who are going to just berate the shit out of you. Think about everyone else that's actually watching.
All right. Okay. Overall, I thought your series was I thought that was really good. If someone's watching this and they're looking to get into casting, I think these videos, like, I guess I started it off, but whatever comes next, I think this is really good. But for the most part, when you were pointing out things that I did wrong, like, I knew, like, I shouldn't have done that. And I, when I made these highlights, I specifically kind of just picked random team fights so that I wasn't, pre-screening it to make sure, like, oh, that was perfect. Like, Toby can't find anything wrong in this.
Now, that's a good thing. I kind of actually didn't do what I wanted to do because I kind of found enough points. Like, I wanted to randomly grab other things which you didn't select just because of that. But there was a lot of different things I kept finding through a broadcast, which just,
As a commentator,
there's so much to talk about. I couldn't believe it, actually.
As a commentator, if you ever go back, you're always going to find tons of mistakes. And
casts are long too. Like, it's an hour and a half of you talking straight, and like,
oh shoot, that's an hour and a half.
It'd be really hard to have a perfect.
Holy fuck! No wonder I feel tired.
Perfect go.
Wait, this video. I think he was talking about just game length.
Oh, okay. That was like, all right. Whew, thank God. Okay, maybe I shouldn't feel that tired then. I'm getting old.
And you have many, many hours to go. You better wake up.
Do you have any questions about commentating in general, or anything that you've always kind of wondered, or?
It's really hard to put someone on the spot like that because it's like there's so many things which, after he hangs up this call, he'll be like, yeah, I kind of thought about that. Like, you need to have some kind of like spark.
Well, my question to casting, I don't know if it's specific, it's more general. Like, what do you make of the different styles? Like, Toby, obviously you're pretty much the hype caster. Capitalist does obviously a great job at that as well. I know like my limits. Like, I don't think I can build an incredible amount of hype. So I try to be a little more specific during team fights. And then there's obviously sort of the comedy pairings that something's happening, they're kind of making jokes, and I think those are also enjoyable, especially with, like, the onslaught of how many games in a row there are. Like, as a viewer, it's just fun to laugh, you know? So what are your thoughts on the different styles?
Okay, that's an interesting question. As far as the styles go, the style still comes back to, like, the core principle, who's your viewership base. Like, for example, Cyclops. This guy gets so much love. But he's a YouTube personality. Like, that's one of those things where you have to understand he's actually not a commentator. He's a pure...
He's an entertainer.
He's an entertainer. Sir Action Slacks is the same. Like, Sir Action Slacks, I wouldn't actually class as a commentator. I class him as an entertainer. Because everything he does, he tries to entertain every second of the game. And that's one of those things where... Like, those kind of styles have their purpose, but I think a lot of the time the styles get lost because everything just blends together. There's just this one term called commentator or shoutcaster, and it covers everything, and it shouldn't. And it's also because a lot of people try and make a career in this industry, and they think they need to do everything, or they feel like commentary is the only way you'll ever be able to, like... make it in this scene. And the funny thing is, it's not. Molini actually would do better to stop casting and just do...
Well, that sounds like a terrible statement right up.
Okay.
Clarify.
Clarify. This is when we actually follow up our initial comment with
Nobody create a Reddit thread just yet.
We talked about this. But he would make a lot more money and a lot more popularity by actually not being a caster. And when I say caster, I mean doing what Cap and I do. Like, in front of a camera, commentating a game, co-caster, play-by-play guy. What he'd make more money and more popularity and more respect more than anything else in doing is doing analytical videos, talking and breaking down things which he knows, expressing that logic. We were talking about it during this entire segment, where we said, in a broadcast, you've only got a certain amount of time to say a certain amount of stuff. And there's no way you can express what you know during that period of time, especially if you're a play-by-play person, because it's not your job. And if you start doing that, then you actually cripple your co-caster. Like, people like Molini, for example, if we use him as a case study, his YouTube video should be a priority. He can still travel to LAN events and actually gain a lot of money from doing so, because obviously you get paid when you do your LAN events. But you also get your popularity, you get your exposure you're searching for, which keeps your brand relevant to a larger community, like the competitive community. And you basically, you get hired for analyst desks. Because you
which
prove,
he has been.
Yeah, which he has been. But he also doubles. Like, that's the interesting thing with Merlini. He ends up doubling. But it means he also splits his time. He doesn't focus on one or he doesn't focus on the other. And when you stream for 14 hours straight, obviously, you're never going to have the time or energy to focus on one or the other. You just try and get through the work you've got. So that's just one of those things where, like, if we talk about the different types, people should understand exactly what the types are before they try and focus on that kind of stuff. Like, types, if you're talking like oh, it's a hype guy, it's an analytical guy, it's something like that, then you're kind of losing sight of what the combo is or what your audience actually is. Because still, at the end of the day, this should be a professional production. The broadcast itself is what I'm talking about. Like, when you're commentating a game, you should be as professional as you possibly can. You should follow the rules, follow the structure, do what every commentator does in every single scene. It's a little bit unique in esports because the esports community wants to be a lot closer to the personalities that are giving them the information. We can actually blame Day 9 a lot for all of this because he was the first guy who really made it massive as a commentator. Like Tasteless and Artosis, they did really well for themselves out in Korea, but it wasn't really that global exposure. It didn't really set a massive trend. They're the most experienced out there. But Day 9 was actually, for me, one of the primary ones who set the trend for commentators who were massively successful, had a hype behind them. Like, I remember the Day 9 tent at DreamHack. That shit was crazy. People would sit outside in what was basically a sauna filled with basic nerd sweat. It was nerd sweat. And the ground was, like, mushy, and it started off as a nice nice grass, and it became slush with, like, these wooden seats. But people would stick it out because they would be there for him. And what he did was he basically made such a huge connection where people loved who he was. And so many people think now, you've still got to be able to achieve that. You've still got to do that. And people still feel, obviously, a strong connection to Sean, but things have changed over time where you now look at it, you look at commentators and you expect a suit, you expect a tie, you expect something a lot more professional. And Sean's actually moved himself more into that role now, in my view, because of just like what's been asked of him. Like Blizzard flies around to a whole bunch of events, StarCraft 2, they raise the bar for production and quality of events. So you kind of lose that when you become more professional. So, for me, I'd say people should understand broadcasting should be professional. If you want to make fun, if you want to joke about things, that kind of stuff is meant for chat shows. It's meant for, like, those debating kind of shows where you just make... You poke the piss out of everything that's there. And just because you've got a game going on the screen in front of you, it's not really focus piss. It's just piss for the sake of piss. So, if you're going to do that kind of stuff, then focus your stuff. Actually make it an entertaining show that I don't have to sit there for 4 hours just so I can get a couple of giggles, which I can then post up on Reddit. I should be able to get that after 30 minutes of my time and not waste it hanging around. So, okay, then there's your piss shows. And then you've got your comedy stuff. The great people about this, like the best thing about comedy is working on the emotions of your viewership. Now, Lysander and Cyclops actually do this perfectly. Lysander is Twitch chat when he broadcasts. And Twitch chat loves that because it's them. So he relates perfectly on that level and he'll always have backing because of this. But it puts him into that kind of category of a commentator. He's the comedy kind of guy. Sunsfan does something very, very similar. And we saw what went wrong at TI4 when you try and put two comedy guys together.
Yeah.
Both and just the really, format really of funny. The game.
The format of the game wasn't that bad, like because you could still have a lot of fun. Like you saw what Wagra and I did at TI3. Like, and what we did was, well, we keep it structured. We still keep focusing on the action. There's still a little bit of play by play. We could have done that so much better. And looking in retrospect, I learned a lot during the All-Star match of TI3, because I realized that. Like, you don't have to destroy, like, you can add in elements of comedy but you need to have the experience and structure still there.
Yeah.
And the important thing, like, if you actually put Sunsfan and Lysander into a room and gave them both five times the amount of confidence that they didn't have at that event, because it was the first time they'd ever been put in that situation. Yeah, we're going to put you in the middle of Key Arena. You're casting to all these people. You're going to cast an event where
there's explosions.
Is massive explosions, so there's no way you can, like, if you're the first time in a stadium going, yeah, I'm composed and can do a job really well. Oh, they couldn't do it. Everything was against them, and they hadn't had any pairing work.
No, they just threw, Valve was just basically you and you. Go together.
Yeah.
It could have been so much better.
And they knew about it like three days before the event. Yeah. All the time they had to work out. And they actually didn't talk to each other before that point. I can take that back. I remember Lysander saying there was a point when they actually got together and talked about some stuff. But again, a 10-15 minute conversation is not going to achieve shite. Yeah. You need to have time. It would have been better to have Syndra and Sunsfan together doing that, and they proved during their Captain's Draft tournament that that's the kind of element that they're really capable of achieving.
Yeah.
So you have to look at these combinations.
Sunsfans and Reeves would have actually been really good.
Yeah.
Because all their experience doing all the fails, they have a really good... you can't just break up a comedy duo and pair it up with something else.
Agreed.
Lysander, we would give a similar example to Lysander, but... Lysander is more of a solo caster, right? It's not we're poking like, oh, it's Sunsfan and somebody's Sunsfan. It's just, I don't know who Lysander would pair up with.
Lysander's hard to pair because he's a solo caster.
Yeah.
And that's the way he always functions.
And he's really good at being able to provide solo entertainment.
Yeah. It's the same with Cyclops. Like, he's great for solo entertainment. But what I'd actually prefer to see from Cyclops is highlight videos of different plays where he just basically does his thing talking about it. Like, it's his accent and the way he describes things, which is normally the most entertaining kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So if he could find a way to enhance that into, like, a YouTube video, this guy would be a pop sensation straight away. Like, that's the kind of stuff that's like Kitty in a Box. Oh my God, it's amazing! Like, that's the kind of level which people have to realize you can achieve. And you don't get it from just commentating, because you look at the Dota 2 scene right now, there's 5 million commentators out there. It's very difficult to get noticed. And even when you do, it's only going to be for a week. And it doesn't mean you're going to get a gig, especially if you're their type of commentator. Like, ESL's not going to go, yeah, you know what? Cyclops. Really good caster. We'll hire him for professional production for a big event. They wouldn't do that. You would think maybe, hey, Cyclops, we'll hire him for some comedy relief in between the games. Yeah, you think about that. But that means you've got to sell yourself and market yourself as that kind of person. Mm.
Hang on, on the back burner.
Sorry, say again.
I have to chime in here because I think a lot of the people in Twitch that didn't quite get your point. You never ever, or rather Toby never ever said he doesn't like Malini's casting or Malini is a bad caster.
Oh, yeah. No.
The only thing Toby is saying is, I would like to see him doing this and that because he would be perfect for that. With that statement, he never said that what he's doing right now isn't good.
Yeah,
so please don't confuse that, because that's never anything he said about any of those casters.
We work with Syndrin and Merlini at ESL for the exact reason. Yeah. I feel like
Merlini can be conflicted because the outcry from the community is, oh, the color has to be a pro player to break things down analytically. So, like, we think that's what everyone wants. So Merlini rises to the occasion when maybe he could... probably be making more ground just on his own doing solo stuff.
It's not actually... Yeah, that's actually... that you're 100% right. That's exactly what it is. Breaking more ground doing something else which is more suited to your abilities, to your talents. That's what it's all about. Like, we're not saying this person's shit. We're not saying this person's also shit. Like, we're saying this person's really good at this. They should enhance that. As opposed to...
Enhance!
Trying to be this all-rounder kind of person... which doesn't really achieve much at the end of the day, or achieve something, but it's still being carried by the other primary point. That's going. Thank you very much, sir, for the clarity. It's the chat struggling with this concept.
The moment you came up with that, I was just like,
chat and concepts. Can you even put that in the same sentence and have it make sense?
Sometimes I believe in the chat. And, like, I know I keep using this quote. I've said this quote to Cap. I think I've actually mentioned it to Zoe before as well. Like, you can't blame somebody for not knowing something if you never taught it to them in the first place. So I can't blame chat for basically going off their rock. I can blame them for not listening. Like, that's one thing I can do. But I can't blame them for not understanding the concept when this is, like, the first time they hear the concept or they they try and understand the concept. You're always going to have teething issues. Someone tells me what to do, I say, fuck it. I'm going to learn on my own. And eventually I'll come back to the initial person that taught me what it was all about and go, you know what? Yeah, you're right. But that takes time.
Another quick question, maybe since we brought up chat. Do you think you had like professional cast, is there a way to professionally like mention chat? Because if you look at like a traditional sports announcer, like they'll hype up their audience, right? And our audience in this case is chat.
They'll hype up their audience, but at the same time, like those guys commentate from inside of booths. Their screens are giving them stats and information, which makes their job better. They're not looking and seeing, oh my God, chat's talking about this and that. they're not doing that because then they're not doing their job. They're not doing their job correctly because they're not controlling the flow. They're coming in and then allowing a chat to modify what they do. Like the closest you could get to that is a crowd is screaming for something and your hype level will rise. So sure, if we can see 5 million cappers a minute, your hype level will rise. But that's the only thing you're going to do. Like the faster the chat moves, the more hyped you try and make them or whatever the hell, like that kind of thing. But you can't dictate your broadcast off chat. Really, as someone already
definitely
fucking
missed
done
kills
it.
Looking
no,
at
no,
chat
no.
before.
Oh no, it's a positive thing. I honestly thought Cap was looking at Reddit,
Toby's
and it was just
like
fucking
oh,
Merlini's
no.
a dick heard by Toby one right here. And it's like no, Merlini is extremely talented and he's got a lot he can do.
And we work with.
And he's very
Merlini, he's very
smart about this kind of stuff as well.
We think they're good co-casters.
Yes.
Yeah, I cast with Merlini once, and I wasn't ready for it initially. Like, he started talking, I was like, whoa, this is full-throttle casting. Like, we're going now.
Do you notice that as well? Like with co-casters who really, really know their stuff, that's why it's really difficult at first to cast with a pro player. Because when you cast with someone like Nahaz, for example, or just like a casual person, like if I was your co-caster.
Good God.
Yeah, God help you then. You'll be used to a certain level. You're used to a certain quality and you'll know that you can bounce off ideas back and forward. And then you realize that you're sitting next to a pro player and your ideas next to his look like preschool drawings. And he's writing a freaking like master's paper. And you're like, shit. What do I do here? I have no idea what to do. And this will be your initial reaction when you cast with someone that's just so much better than you in a certain area. And Merlini has one of those personalities where if you try and debate it with him, he'll just be like, what the fuck are you talking about? All right. It's just what happens. And like Puppy will do the same kind of thing when you cast with him. He actually got a little bit nicer over time. But initially when Puppy was cool, first like doing a lot of casting with me, he would just be like, dude, you're wrong. And I'm like, oh.
Okay.
And that's when you have to accept, like, you normally need a very thick skin as a commentator to deal with all the shit that you get. And even then, it will still penetrate.
Definitely.
It will still get through. And most of the time, casters use ego to deal with that. Like, you'll come up and you go, okay. I don't give a shit what you say. Fucking right. Just get away from me. I'm doing things my way. And this will happen when you lose complete control. And every caster will go through this at some point, unless you are one of the nicest people in the world. I went through this twice. Actually, technically three times. I quit casting for 6 months the second time this happened.
Toby, before we get into this,
yeah.
do you want to wrap this up with Let Helium Go? We'll end the section for the YouTube
Let
VOD.
Let me be free.
We'll end the section for the YouTube VOD, and then we could do
a bit of a question time or whatever afterwards. Yeah, we could have our casual talk.
All right. Well, hey, You're Helium, right. thanks for
You're
coming
right.
on, man.
You're right.
Again, like I think you have a lot of potential. That's why I brought you on here.
You were the first Cap.
Thanks, buddy. I'm not sure what that means.
No, you were like one of my first Twitter followers, like way back in the day. So I know you've always had a watchful eye over my casting.
Again, it's just you have the core basics down.
Yeah.
And you can tell that in a caster. Like, you mess up
you,
other
you
things.
You just need experience.
Happens,
you just need experience, and you need, like, this refinements. Like, a lot of the tips out there. I suggest you also look at Red Eyes Guide, which
yeah,
is
yeah, I was reading through that the other day, actually.
Yeah, there's a lot of information in there. And most of the time, though, it doesn't really make a lot of sense until you do something. This is the reason why we wanted to do this the way we did it, where we physically take a look at what you do, and then we decode it from there. Because if you read a whole bunch of shit on a screen, it's nowhere near as useful. It's nowhere near as interactive. It's you don't have like real world application for a lot of this stuff. It's just in your brain, but you don't really comprehend it. Like, how many people went to high school, read a textbook, and said, "I remember everything that was inside that book, and I comprehend everything." Very, very few people can say that, unless you're just a genius. At which point, I'm so fucking jealous. My brain is stupid. yeah. So that's I hope a lot of this stuff can help out. We're gonna do more of this. We're doing at least one more tonight. Okay. At least one more tonight.
I will be watching and learning.
If you're watching, good luck. I think it's like 2 a.m. in the morning. so
probably
something like that. Unless we get more outcry to have this again. But we've definitely taken up too much of everyone else's time. So thanks for watching this show, everyone. If you want to see more of this stuff, we'll do more of it. Let us know. Tweet us out. You can give us your support. I'm not going to mention the thread because I'm not allowed to because it breaks rules. But you know where to go. And you can leave comments in the section below on the YouTube videos, which will upload all of these as well. So all these segments which we've been doing, so both Durka's team fight recap, Cap looking at all the teams as well. Yeah, all that kind of jazz. You can check it out on our YouTube Plus. We're going to put it on Joy Dota Plus. We're going to put it on Joy Dota Plus now. So you'll be able to find it over on our YouTube channel. So for now, thanks for watching. Everyone follow Heliumbrella. He's over on Twitter. Good luck, man, in the future.